Thanks a lot, Nikhil. Thanks a lot also for inviting me to give this lecture. It's a big pleasure to be here. So I want to talk about hierarchies of relaxations for polynomial optimization. And this is going to be a talk which is based on some several papers, which is joint work since a couple of years, actually, with my colleague Etienne de Clercq in Tilburg, also with our student Zhao San, who defended a few months ago. And there is some recent work with Jean Lasserre and some older work with Pablo Parrilo. So I want to talk about polynomial optimization, and maybe I should stress that actually in my lecture I will deal with continuous polynomial optimization. So I'm not going to focus on, of course, polynomial optimization captures also discrete optimization. You just add constraint which says that a variable should be binary. But in my lecture, I will deal with continuous optimization. So I hope you forgive me for that. So this is a problem I want to look at. You have a polynomial function, here is one, and you want to minimize this function over a region, K, which is delimited by polynomial inequality. So this is a very general setting of polynomial optimization. Compute the minimum of f, which I will call f min, which is a minimum of f over k. So of course, this is a very general problem, and it's a hard problem. And it's hard already on very simple, so such a set in general, that's a basic closed semi-algebraic set. But it's already hard if you take very simple sets like the standard simplex, where you say that all variables should be non-negative summing up to 1. It's also hard if you just deal with k is a hypercube or if k would be the unit sphere. And simple reason is because you can capture hard combinatorial optimization problems like maxcat or maximum stable set problem via polynomial optimization on one of these simple sets. This is well known, but let's just maybe recall such results. So for instance, it's a classic result of Motzkin-Strauss. That you can compute the stability number by optimizing a quadratic form over the standard simplex. So the quadratic form here is this thing here, where this is identity plus the adjacent symmetrics of the graph. You can also compute the stability number by maximizing this quadratic form over the cube. It's also not difficult to see. And also maxcat can be obtained by reformulating over the hypercubes. It's well known, so here this is quadratic form, which involves the Laplacian matrix of the graph. What about the sphere? Well, it's also hard because Nesterov, for instance, showed that you can compute the stability number by maximizing now this form of degree 3 over the standard, over the unit sphere. Of course, if you would put here a quadratic polynomial, then it's eigenvalue and that's easy, but from degree 3 on, it's hard. So polynomial optimization over such simple sets is already hard. So what to do? So then a classical idea, I mean, natural idea is to try to build hierarchies of bounds for it, which could be either lower bounds or upper bounds. So what I want now to discuss is some general techniques to build lower bounds and upper bounds, and then we'll go on to what I want to do in the talk. So how to get lower bounds? So f min is the minimum of f over k. That's what we want to find. And there is by now a very classic machinery which has been developed in the, throughout the years, which is based on using LP or SDP relaxations to build such bounds. So this is this started with the work of Shore, then Nesterov, and Parrilo Lasserre have developed all these techniques. So what is the basic idea? So the basic idea is quite simple. You want to find the minimum of f over k. That's the same thing as finding the largest scalar lambda for which f is at least lambda over the set k. Another way to say it is you want to find the largest scalar lambda for which the polynomial f minus lambda is non-negative over set k. But now, checking whether these non-negativity conditions, this is hard. So then the basic idea is to replace this hard condition by some other sufficient condition, which is easier to test. So how to get a sufficient condition? Well, naturally, what you can do is look at the constraints which define k, because they are, by definition, they are non-negative over k, and try to express your objective function f minus lambda as a combination of constraints or of products of constraints. And then you have the liberty to decide that your conic combination will either involve multipliers which are non-negative scalars or multipliers which are sums of squares. So this is a basic idea to get hierarchies. So, and we will look at, here are three basic types which have been looked at. So the first idea would be to try to express our polynomial f minus lambda. That's the one which we are trying to get non-negative over k. And then we try to express it as a conic combination of products of constraints. This is what this is, your product of constraints. And here the variable is lambda alpha, which is a non-negative scalar. So this would be an LP type bound, because searching for the lambdas is linear programming. And I call it Handelman type, and it will come clear in a second why I use this name for it. Other idea would be to now look at the products of constraints, but the multipliers sigma j are now allowed to be sums of squares of polynomials. And because now I take multipliers to sums of squares, I don't need to take here higher degrees, higher powers of the constraint, because if I have a power 2, I push it into the sum of squares. And this is Schmidtgen type, will become clear in on the next slide why I call it this way. And so finally, the third kind of decomposition, which you could look at, is the same thing as here, but a simpler form. Instead of, you don't now look at products of constraints, you just take the constraints one by one. So you try to represent it as a sum of squares sigma zero plus sum of sigma j, gj, where the sigma j are sums of squares. And this I call Putin-Art type, as will come clear on the next slides. So the first one, this is LP, and the last two involve sums of squares. This is something you can do with SDP. Well, if you want to really get something which is computable, of course, you should put a degree bound. So pick an integer r, and let's put a degree bound on all the polynomials which are involved in this thing. So like here, I say that this term here should have degree at most r. This big term here should have degree at most r. And every term here has degree at most r. And in this way, you get a hierarchy of bounds. And by construction, the strongest bound is a Schmidtgen type one, which is the second one, and it dominates the Handelman type and the Putin-Art type, and these two are not comparable. Okay, so having such a decomposition is sufficient for non-negativity over the set K, but it's not an if and only if. And that's the crux of all these things, is that if you want to get this condition to hold, you have to assume strict positivity. And these are these results from a real algebraic geometry, which tell you at the end of the day that these bounds are going to converge asymptotically to the minimum. So let me just recall these results, these representation results. So we assume that the set K is compact. Actually, in the talk, throughout the talk, the set K will be compact. So these representation results shall now tell you hold when the set K is compact. And we assume that we have a polynomial f which is strictly positive on the set K. And then the claims are as follows. First, in the case when K is a full dimensional polytope, meaning that the GJ have degree 1, then f admits such an LP-based decomposition. So it can be realized as a conic combination of products of constraints. And this result is due to Handelman and Krivine in a more general setting. So that's why I call this type of bounds Handelman type bounds. Second result of Schmidtgen is when K is compact and F is strictly positive on K, then F admits such a decomposition as a conic combination of products of constraints where the multipliers are sums of squares. So that's why I call this second bound Schmidtgen type bound. And finally, there is a result of Putin-Art, which is a bit sharpening of the result of Schmidtgen, which says that take K compact and assume a tiny little bit more about K. Namely, you assume, for instance, that at least it's known as Archimedean condition, but this, in our setting, we can just say, assume that at least one of the constraints which defines K has a level set which is compact. So for instance, a very simple way to satisfy this would be set K is compact, so there is it's contained in a ball, and just add the redundant ball constraint to the description, and then the condition will be satisfied. And in this situation, then we can we can claim that F has a much simpler sum of squared decomposition. You don't need to look at the products of constraints. So that's the result of Putin-Art. And actually, the bounds based on this other one, which are most often used in practice, because it's cheaper to compute. You don't need to go over all the pairwise products of constraints. So this has this representation of results from real algebraic geometry, which underlies the whole methodology and justify why all these bounds converge, why it makes sense to look at these bounds. So this result give you immediately that these hierarchies of bounds converge asymptotically to the minimum of f over the set K. So these hierarchies have been studied. The hierarchy of bounds based on Putinar result is actually what is usually called Lasserre hierarchy. And that's what's used most often in practice, because it's cheaper to compute and it performs very well in practice. And there are also some very nice theoretical properties, for instance, finite convergence holds. For instance, there are some criteria which you can check, all these flatness conditions. There are some concrete criteria which you can check, and if they are satisfied, then you know that the bound which you computed was in fact exact. And also, Jaron Ni has shown that finite convergence actually holds generically. You take a generic class of problems, and you will have finite convergence. So the question which I want to address today in this lecture is actually, what about the rate of convergence? How fast, what can we say? How fast does the bound go to the minimum? So there are actually some general results which have been shown. Schweighofer have analyze the quality of the Schmidtgen type bounds. So here's a very general result which holds for any basic closed semi-algebraic set K and rescale to be put into the cube. And then he showed the following. There exists a constant C, so this constant depends only on the set K, so that you have this rate of convergence for any polynomial F. So the rate of convergence is in 1 over R to the root R, and there is a C coming here in the base of the root. So it's a nice result, but there is this unknown constant. And later, together with Jawang Ni, they have also analyzed the Putinar type bounds. And then they have the same kind of results, but the dependence on R is actually now in 1 over root of the logarithm of R. And again, there is a constant C coming into the picture, which is unknown, which depends on the set K. So of course, these are very general results for any basic closed semi-algebraic set. So that may explain that maybe the bounds are not as nice as you would like, but at least it motivates trying to get maybe better results, or at least to have concrete convergence rate for some simple sets. And this is part of the things I want to tell you today, is that actually it will boil down to say that in for the Schmidtgen type bounds, we can actually take this constant equal to 1. So just 1 over actually equal to 2, because I want to get 1 over R, so equal to 2, 1 over R, not one not equal to 1. So for the Schmidtgen type bounds, for the simplex and the cube. And how will, so I will discuss this, but actually what we will do is not look at the Schmidtgen type, we will just analyze actually the weaker Handelmann type bounds. So the analysis will work with the weaker LP bounds. And if you can analyze the weaker bounds, it will also analyze the sharper bounds.
Is it known for general K,
No, they are not essentially tight. No, nothing is known. I mean, very little is known about the lower bounds. I don't expect that they... So maybe we will see later. So for very simple sets, some lower bounds. So I've told you now how to, the basic idea of how to build lower bounds. What about upper bounds before we go to the results? So how to build upper bounds? So the starting point is to use this observation of Lasserre that in order to find the minimum of f over k, you can as well, so let's find your point x in k, minimizing f of x. You can as well now think of, I want to find a probability measure on K, so that the expected value of F over the set K with respect to this probability measure is as small as possible. Just think of mu, the basic mu would be the Dirac measure at the point X, and then you take convex combinations, and so if you take, so this keeps, this is very easy to see, this identity. And what Lasserre proved is that actually, when K is compact, you can restrict yourself to very, I mean, much simpler measures You can restrict yourself to the case when you look at the Lebesgue measure and you take as a density function a sum of squares. So the minimum of f is, you can reformulate it as the minimum of this integral where h is a sum of squares whose integral is equal to 1. And so this is to make it a probability measure. And again, you may ask yourself, so if you bound the degrees of the sum of squares, you get a hierarchy of upper bounds now, converging to the minimum of f. And the same question arises, what about the convergence rate? So this is another result which I want to discuss. So we could show this upper bound in 1. So the convergence rate is at least in 1 over root r. And we don't know whether that's the exact rate of convergence, but at least, yes. I actually mean, it will actually be a case compact.
So it will be achieved?
Yes.
But then
shouldn't H be a Dirac? It's a polynomial. It cannot be a Dirac. I mean,
F can be uniquely minimized on K.
Sure,
not.
Yes.
But then the only H that should work is a Dirac.
If it would be equal to the minimum of F. But this is going, I mean, oh, you mean here. Okay. Maybe here I should put an inf. Yes. I should have put an inf. Yes. So what I had an inf and I changed it to a mean, but it's the mean was for the bound fr. No, you're completely right. Yes, that should be an inf. Yes. But that's why it's an inf, yeah. But it's not going to be attained. Yeah. So it cannot be, it cannot be attained. Oh, of course, if you forget SOS, then okay, it's a little mean, yes, because then, but I don't forget it. So maybe it's, anyway, if it is not here, if instead of F mean here, you put the bound FR, then it's a mean. So maybe let me, so this is one way to get upper bounds. So this is very general, and it works when K is an arbitrary compact set, yes? But if you have a special set like the simplex or like the cube, you can do a much simpler thing. You can just tell yourself, for instance, this very naive idea, I'm going to minimize over the grid points with a given denominator. That's a much simpler idea and much more natural idea. And this can be also analyzed, and we will see the rate of convergence of these things. Good, so let's get started. So what I want to do is to analyze, tell you something about the rate of convergence for the what I call the regular grid upper bounds, for the simplex and the cube, and for the linear programming lower bounds based on Hondelmann hierarchy for the simplex and the cube. Then we will move to the analyzing this upper bound based on sums of squares densities. And I will then turn back to the case of the cube where we will see how to get other upper bounds by using other density functions and sums of squares. Okay, let's start. We start with a simplex. So if you want to minimize a polynomial over the simplex, well, sum of xi is equal to 1, so I can just assume without loss of generality that the polynomial is homogeneous. If you have a degree which is not a full degree, you just multiply by sum of xi to the suitable power. So let me just recall what we want to analyze. These are now, this has a lower bound for the minimum, which are obtained by minimizing f over all grid points with given denominator r. So this is what this set delta n r means, all rational points in the simplex with denominator r. So for instance, n equals 3, this is standard simplex, and if r would be 3, this you would want to minimize over these red points. And let me just put you out the explicit formula, what you want to do for the upper bound, for further reference. What about the lower bounds? Let me just recall what we want to do. We want to analyze, So we get the lower bounds by looking at the Hausdorff type. So we look at the largest lambda, for which f minus lambda is a conic combination of constraints. So for the simplex, the constraints are xi non-negative. So if you take a product of those, it simply means that you are going to get a term h of x, which is a polynomial with non-negative coefficients. Okay? And then if you use, there is one more constraint, which defines the simplex, which is sum of xi is equal to 1. So if you take a product of constraint which involves this, then because it's an equality, then you have no signs. So this will give you a term which lies in the ideal generated by the polynomial 1 minus sum of xi. Okay? So this is how the Hausdorff type bound is defined. But there is actually a much simpler way, or more handy way to look at it, which is as follows. So first let me say what is happening here. So the statement is that the supremum of lambda satisfying this is equal to the supremum of lambda satisfying this. So how do we move between two lines? So here we have f minus lambda. So first you make it homogeneous by multiplying lambda by the sum of xi to the power d. Now it's homogeneous. And then what you do is you multiply this polynomial by the power of sum of xi to the power r minus d. And the claim is that the supremum lambda for f minus lambda having a decomposition like this is equal to the supremum lambda for which this polynomial has non-negative coefficients. And this is not easy to, it's not difficult to go from between these two formulations. And why did I say Hausdorff meets polya? Well, this is a Hausdorff decomposition, and this is a polya type decomposition. So why polya? So here I'm using an old result of polya, which says the following. If you have a polynomial, homogeneous, which is strictly positive on the standard simplex, then you can multiply the polynomial by a suitable power of sum of xi, and you are going to get a polynomial with non-negative coefficients. So this is a result of polya. And so this is this such a thing here is a polya type decomposition. And it's handy to do this because now it's very easy to give a closed form formula for this parameter, because this is a polynomial and you are just asking that it has non-negative coefficients. So compute the coefficients and write what it means that you have positive coefficients, non-negative coefficients. And in this way, you arrive to this closed form. So this Hausdorff bound is equal to the minimum over the integer sequences summing up to R of this thing. So if you look at this, and at the top here, they look exactly the same, except that we have this d on the line, while we had here the power rd, and the same with on the top. And this here, this means that you take the falling factorial. So what this is saying is that these two bounds look the same, but here we are doing the same thing, but to a small perturbation of the polynomial. So this is saying somehow that these two bounds are very closely related and they can be analyzed at the same time. And it's exactly what's happening. You can analyze both bounds at the same time with the same kind of techniques. So now what I want to do is to tell you how are we going to, what kind of tool can we do, how can we go about to analyze the quality of the upper bound. Yeah? So to analyze the upper bound, so the upper bound is you want to minimize the polynomial over all the grid points with a given denominator. That's what you want to do. And now what we can do is use this, there are many ways to present it, but one way is we are going to use this idea of that Nesterov introduced, which is to do a random walk on the integer lattice. And this goes as follows. So you start at the origin, and if you are at a point on the integer lattice, or should say. So we do a random walk, but we need the probability, so we fix a point x in the standard simplex. So the coordinates of x are non-negative and they sum up to 1, so we use them as probabilities to guide our walk. So if we are at a given point, we have to decide how to walk on the lattice, so we have to choose a standard unit vector, either walk along e1 or e2 or e3, and we decide to walk along ei with probability xi. If you add yr, you walk along ei with probability xi. So this defines your sequence of points on the integer lattice. And it's not difficult to see that this sequence of points follows a multinomial distribution. Which means that you can tell exactly what is the probability that at step r you are at a given point alpha in the integer lattice. And now, so these points, after r steps, you have reached a point which has, you have walked r times, so the sum of coordinates is equal to r. So if you divide by r, you get a point in the, you get a rational point with denominator r. So this is our xr, which is a grid point with denominator r. And so if we look at the expected value of the polynomial at this r point, it's an upper bound on the minimum. And we know exactly how this expected value looks like because we know these probabilities, and this expected value looks like this. So the sum of f evaluated at all the grid points multiplied this multinomial term. So you could also just forget about all this story of random walks, because if you look at it, it's clear that this is lower bounded by the minimum. This is just a multinomial theorem, because we started with our point x in the simplex. And actually, this quantity actually is also comes up in approximation theory. This is nothing but the Bernstein approximation of f at order r. So Bernstein approximations are a classical tool in approximation theory to, given a continuous function f, how to get a sequence of polynomials which converge to your starting function uniformly over the simplex. And this is exactly the Bernstein approximation. So somehow analyzing the quality of this upper bound, the grid-based bounds, amounts to looking, understanding how the Bernstein approximation behaves. And so if you, it's very easy now to see that actually this is the thing which we are interested to bound, how far is the grid point upper bound from the minimum. We can upper bound it by this minimum of this thing, minus f min, and now you can, again, it's not difficult to see that this is at most is. And actually, this is what we are going to work with. We are going to upper bound this range here. And the analysis is going to, and now it makes sense because this is a Bernstein approximation of f minus f. So, and we know it's going to, so this is the quality of this, which we are. So here are the results. So Bomsey and de Klerk in 2002 had already done the case of a quadratic polynomial, so they showed this result. So this is upper bound on the, how far is this grid point upper bound? It's exactly at most 1 over r times the range of values over the simplex. For the lower bound, you have about the same result. And if you have a polynomial of degree at least 2, together with Pablo Parrilo, we extended the result. So now we had 1 here, but now in the case of an arbitrary polynomial of degree at least 2, you have a constant CD, or C prime D, depending only on the degree. Yeah. And so if we observe one thing I should have said already much earlier, is that computing this upper bound, computing the minimum of the grid point of a given denominator, this can be done in polynomial time because you have to do order n to the r function evaluations. So you can do this in polynomial time. So what this, if you look at this inequality, the first one, what this is telling you is that this gives you a polynomial time approximation scheme for minimizing a polynomial over the standard simplex. So that's maybe not the standard, maybe you might not be so familiar with the notion of pitas in the case of continuous optimization, but this is the definition which is usually used in continuous optimization for pitas. You want here your epsilon, and you want to see here the range of values of the function, because you don't know in advance what is the sign of the function values. And it also makes sense because this range is invariant if you would scale f or if you would translate f, for instance. So this gives you a pitas for minimizing a polynomial of fixed degree over the standard simplex. So fixed degrees, because here we have this constant which depends only on the degrees. If you minimize a polynomial which is not homogeneous, make it homogeneous. But if you have a term of degree smaller, you just multiply by sum of xi to the suitable power. So the analysis, at the end of the day, so to do the proofs, you need homogeneous, but at the end of the day, this is true also for a non-homogeneous polynomial. You don't need it, yeah.
Does the
Which works one, sorry?
You mean?
But this Peter thing here uses a lot the fact that you have this constant which depends only on D and not on the coefficients. So actually, it's a good question because this is about the only slide in the whole talk where we have a constant which depends only on the degree and not on the coefficients or on some other parameters. So all the other convergence results will have a constant which depends in some way on F. So you don't have any such, actually it's open whether such a Peters could exist for the sphere, not known. So, okay, the proof in the quadratic case is two lines, but maybe it's not, it's very easy in the quadratic case. It's just, you look how the Bernstein approximation behaves. And for general degree, you look how the Bernstein approximate, so you have to look at the moments of the multinomial distribution. It's a bit technical. But, so what about, can we make a refined, is 1 over r the right value or not? Can we do better? So let's first look at an example. If you just take f is the sum of xi squared, then you can compute everything, and you get, for instance, that when r is equal to 3n over 2, you have an equality here. So 1 over 6 r minus 9 times this range of values. So what this is saying is that actually this convergence rate in 1 over r is tight if you want the Peters property. You cannot hope to find the Peters with 1 over r to some higher power than 1. But you can also show that this thing for any r is at most n over 4 r squared. So if you now are happy with a constant which depends on n or on f, then you can show a better rate of convergence, r squared. And actually, this is true not only for this example, it's actually true in general, and that's actually very easy. And it relies on just using a Taylor theorem and the fact that if you have a point in the simplex, you have a given denominator, you can find a point in the rational grid point close to the point. So it's actually easy to get this 1 over r squared convergence result. But the price to pay is that you have a constant which depends on the polynomial. So one other thing which we had done before was actually, if you assume that your polynomial is a bit special in the sense that it has a rational minimizer and call m the denominator, then you can get, again, the r squared rate of convergence, but the constant looks a bit better. It's a constant which depends on d times the denominator. So somehow, the polynomial enters only via the denominator of the global minimizer. And this was done by using the hypergeometric distribution instead of the multinomial distribution. So this term. Okay, so what about the hypercube? So for the hypercube, somehow we can do kind of everything I've now told you about the simplex. It works about the same for the hypercube, so I'm not going to spend too much time. The upper bounds, you could again look at the minimizing over the grid point with a given denominator on the hypercube. For the lower bound, you would do again the Hondemann type lower bounds. And we can show this result. So again, the convergence 1 over r for the Hondemann type lower bounds and 1 over r squared for the upper bounds. But, with a but, these grid points upper bounds are maybe not too interesting because how many grid points do you have? You have r plus 1 to the n, so you have an exponential number of them. So you can show convergence in 1 over r, but that's quite difficult to compute this upper bound. So we will see later some other technique which could be used to get upper bounds with rate of convergence in 1 over r, which would be more economical to compute. And the analysis is again based on Bernstein approximations. Okay, so maybe now we move to the question of analyzing these upper bounds for the minimum of f over k using sums of square densities. Yeah? So let me just recall what I showed you already a few slides ago, these results of Lasserre, who showed that K is compact. When K is compact, the minimum of F is the minimum, well, the infimum over there. And where you choose your sum of square density. And to get an upper bound of order r, you restrict yourself to a sum of square h of degree at most 2r. And the question which I want to look, okay. So what I want to look at is what is the rate of convergence, but let's first maybe make some observation. Well, it's a nice formulation, but first question is how, so checking a sum of squares, this is SDP, but in order to be able to compute it, you have to be able to evaluate this integral here. So you have to be able to evaluate the moments over the set K. So if K is arbitrary, there's not much you can do. If you don't know the moments, you cannot compute. But at least for some simple sets like the simplex or the cube or the ball or the sphere, you can, the new moments are known. You have closed form formula for the moment, so you could compute this integral. But aside from that, it's, I think it might be interesting to understand what is the rate of convergence of these bounds. So what we can show is the following. So assume the set K is compact and is nice. So I tell you the next slide what it means to be nice. But for instance, if K is a convex body, it's nice. The theorem would hold for it. And the only assumption we make, I mean, F could be a polynomial, probably more interesting in polynomial, but this theorem holds when f is just a Lipschitz function, with Lipschitz for constant m, f. And then the theorem says that you can find constant ck and rk for which this rate of convergence holds. So 1 over root r, and the constant is just the constant which depends on set k times the Lipschitz constant of the function. And this is true for r large enough. Okay, so what I want now to do is to give you some ideas how to show this thing. But first maybe let me show you some examples. Nice to see some pictures. So for instance, here is a Motzkin polynomial, which this was a polynomial we saw at the first slides already, which you want to minimize over the box, the cube, minus 2, 2. And it's known that it has four global minimizers, and we see them. Well, we don't see them too well, but it's 1, 2. Sorry, this is supposed here to be to go down. So here would be the sum of square density, which you the optimal sum of square density, which you find if you run the program at order 6, which means that you look for an optimal sum of square density of degree 12. So you see that with this kind of mountains, which start growing. So this is supposed to be a these 4 points minus 1, plus minus 1, plus minus 1. So this is for degree 12. It starts becoming a bit nicer at degree 16. You see the peaks which starts growing, degree 12, degree 24. So what's happening is that your sum, optimal sum of square density is having a peak at each of the four global minimizers. So somehow it's one thing to, what you want is to find, of course, the Dirac the global minimizer, so the convex combination of the Dirac's, and this is what the solver is returning to you for. So how to go about the convergence analysis of this upper bounds? So what we do is we take a global minimizer, let's take it A, and what we would want is to find a sum of square polynomial H, which of degree 2r, if we are trying to understand the degree r bound. And we want such a SOS polynomial which looks like the delta function at A. So how to find such one? I mean, we just need to be able to show the convergence rate. We just need to find one which we are able to analyze. So, and well, the natural idea is look at the Gaussian, because the Gaussian is exactly having the right shape. So this. But with sums of square densities. Yes. Yeah, but it's an easy theorem. I agree. I agree. It's not a difficult thing. It's not a difficult thing. I agree. So we take the Gaussian, yes, this is the one which is going to guide us, and but we want the sum of square density. So what's this basic idea is we are just going to take the truncation of the Gaussian. So it's a basic idea. It's not a difficult idea, I agree. So we take the truncation at a given degree. The only thing to observe is that, so this is a polynomial. That's good. But the only thing to observe now is that it's a sum of squares. And indeed, it is a sum of squares, because actually, this is a multivariate polynomial, but it depends only on the norm. So actually, it's univariate in essence. And why is it a sum of squares? Simply because this univariate underlying polynomial is non-negative over the full line. And now, if you have a univariate polynomial non-negative, it's a sum of squares. So this is a sum of squares. And so it's non-negative because you have this. So it's a sum of squares, that one. And this other, it's another estimate which we are going to use later in the convergence analysis. So we know, so that's why this thing is, we can analyze it because we know all these things about the Gaussian. Okay, so let me just tell a few more things about the convergence analysis. So here is the polynomial which is a sum of squares and which we want to analyze. We need to make it a probability measure on the set K, so we need to find this normalizing constant so that the integral is equal to 1. So let's call it CAR. Yeah? And let's call capital CA the constant which makes the Gaussian over the set K a probability measure. So first, so here is the main result which we are going to show, actually. What we are going to show is that if, so I'm going to say in a minute what it means to be nice at A, but what we are going to show is that this integral here is the difference with the minimum is at most this. And if you can do this, then you have the result you wanted. And what does it mean to be nice? It means the following. Maybe I can better make a picture. So we have an arbitrary set K. So say this is your set K. And the minimizer is somewhere. So what this condition I want is that there is an epsilon, so that if you look at the ball around the minimizer of radius epsilon, it contains a constant fraction of the volume of the full ball. So exists an epsilon k such that the volume of k intersected with is at least a constant fraction of the full ball. And this should be true for every epsilon at most. So what this means, actually, another way to say it, it means that you want to find a cone, an open cone here containing a set. So what would be bad would be a situation if you would have a set like this. So you want to have positive Lebesgue measure in your point A. So here, these conditions would be true for all points, A, except this one and this one. So then it will be a bad point if your minimizer is here, and then because when you go to zero, the volume tends to zero. So this is the only condition which we need. And so what we have to specify is how we are going. So this Gaussian, we have it's centered at the minimizer, but we had to specify what is the variance for this Gaussian. And we are going to take it equal to this epsilon. And we are going to let epsilon to be any number between these two things. And the analysis will tell us that we need to choose epsilon about 1 over root r. So let me maybe say a few things about the analysis. So the crucial thing was this condition, this nicety, that the set should be nice at the minimizer. It will come actually in order to be able to control these normalizing constants. Let's maybe see this. So we can control the constant. So the one, this one is the one which normalizes, which says that the truncation is a probability measure. Is at most this one, which says that the Gaussian is a probability measure on the set K. And the point is that all these constants are bounded by a constant which depends only on the set K and not on the choice of R or epsilon. Because this epsilon enters the definition of the Gaussian via the variance. So that's crucial for the analysis. So let's just see why is this true. First, the normalizing constant for the truncation is at most a normalizing constant for the Gaussian, just because they satisfy this, so that's very easy. And now we just have to lower bound 1 over CA. Let's write it. 1 over CA, by definition, this is the integral of the Gaussian over the ZK. And what we can do is minimize this, I mean, lower bound this integral over K by the integral over K intersection of small ball around A. Yeah? So this inequality is clear. But now, since we are in the ball around K, we know that X minus A is at most epsilon, so we can lower bound the Gaussian by this quantity, constant C over epsilon n. And if we see what this gives us the volume of the set K intersected with this small ball times C over epsilon n. And now this is a point where we use our assumption on the set K. So the volume of a small ball around K, around A intersecting with K, is at least a constant fraction of the volume of the full ball. And now the epsilon n cancels out and we get this constant. So this is the only place in the analysis where we use the fact that this technical condition of the set K. So now our constants are controlled. And how would we go about analyzing the upper bound? So this is what we want to understand, how this difference behave. Well, we use the fact that, right, f of mean is equal to f of a, and use the fact that this is a probability. So you can bring the f of a inside the integral. And now we use the fact that our function f is Lipschitz, continuous. So this is a Lipschitz constant, and now f has disappeared. You don't have to care about f anymore. So you just have to understand how does this integral here behave. And to do that, we go back to the Gaussian. So first, you introduce back the Gaussian, and then you have the difference between the truncation and the Gaussian. So we have two terms, and we have to understand these two terms. And then it's a bit technicalities to show that both terms are at most epsilon times some constants, which depends only on the set K. So for the first term, it's not very difficult. And for this, I don't go over the details. For the second term, it's a bit more technical. And it's actually, for the first term, it was working for any epsilon. There was not yet anything which was telling you that you should choose epsilon of the 1 over epsilon, or root r. It was for any epsilon. But at some point, you get stuck in the proof. And the proof tells you you get such a big term here with r inside, outside, powers, whatever. And in order to get rid of this term, you have to make the middle here equal to 1. And this is what's forcing you to choose epsilon of in 1 over square root of r. So the proof technique implies a convergence rate in 1 over square root of r, but we don't know whether that's the exact rate or not. We don't have a lower bound showing that this should be exact. Okay. So this was what we can do with sums of square densities over an arbitrary set K. And now if we go back to the hypercube, we can actually analyze other density functions instead of taking sums of square densities. The first thing we could do is, instead of having our H here, which is a sum of square density, we could take it to be of Hundelmann type, so to be a conic combination of these products of constraints which define the hypercube. And again, you make it, you ask that the integral is equal to 1, to have it a probability distribution. So this sequence of bound, again, it's not difficult to show. It converges again to the minimum of f over the hypercube. And why to look at such bounds? The point is that these bounds, upper bounds, are actually very trivial to compute. You don't need even to do, so this could be, you could think this is linear programming, because here these are non-negativity conditions on the scalar, lambda. But actually, you don't need to do even linear programming. You just have a closed form formula. Because if you expand here, if you replace the h by its expression here, you are going to get a sum of lambdas times these integrals, and where the sum of the lambdas is equal to 1. So actually, you're minimizing over the simplex. So you get a closed form expression. So this bound, upper bound of order r is going to be the minimum of these terms. So you can just compute all these terms. You know the moment, so you can compute these terms. And you pick the smallest one. This gives you the bound. And if you fix r, now this is polynomial in r, because you have to do order n to the r operations. So it's polynomial. And we can show actually the same rate of convergence, 1 over square root of r, for this upper bound. And in the case when the polynomial has a rational minimizer, then actually you can show a stronger convergence rate. You can show a convergence rate in 1 over r. And the idea is that if you have a rational minimizer, then you use this rational minimizer to create the exponents in your distribution over there. So if you have a rational minimizer, you can do a tighter convergence analysis. And if the rational minimizer, if the minimizer is not rational, then you have to do Diophantine approximation to get those exponents and to make the analysis. And it's why you use, you lose, at least it's how proof does. I don't say that it's optimal. We don't, again, we don't have a lower bound. So this analysis here is, so we choose this upper bounds of this kind, but what this is doing is actually looking at the beta distribution. So, so this beta distribution has this kind of density function. So what all these proofs are doing actually is looking every time at a different kind of distribution to get an upper bound. And we have picked up distributions which we were able to analyze. Let me conclude with one more very recent things which we have been, oh yeah, so first a picture. So this is again the Motzkin polynomial which is now rescaled to have it on the Boolean cube. I mean 0,1 cube. And this is how the optimal sums of density functions would look like for the beta distribution. And in comparison, this is the sum of square distribution. Funny thing which I don't understand is why on this picture here there are only two peaks. Somehow the sum of square distribution has decided to pick up these two peaks and the other one are left aside. I don't know why. While on the previous picture I showed you before, the four peaks were high. And I don't have a good explanation for that. But the beta has just picked one peak. It has, and apparently here it chooses, so there are four minimizers. Here it has chosen this one here. And at a higher degree, it has chosen the other one on the other side of the cube. So that's what the numerics are doing. OK, so I just want to conclude with another recent thing which we are currently working on, which is, so that's again, so the whole thing boils down, so maybe some of you have much better idea how to get a good polynomial which approximates a delta function. This is what the whole talk is about. Find a good polynomial approximation of the delta function. And so we have analyzed some. Maybe you have better ones which would yield to get better convergence rates. But what we have looked at recently is to indeed to look at polynomials which you can get by doing convolution with a Jackson kernel. And it's, so we have found this paper which builds a concrete polynomial delta r, which is a good approximation of the delta function. We don't need to look exactly how it looks like. Let me just say that this is a polynomial which you define in terms of the Chebyshev polynomials. And this coefficient gk are defined explicitly. So there is an explicit formula for these polynomials of degree r, which are supposed to approximate well the delta function at a given point L. But here we scale them by this pi square root 1 minus x squared. So instead of doing using the Lebesgue measure, we use the Lebesgue measure with the scale by this term here. And the reason being that these Chebyshev polynomials form an orthogonal base for this inner product. So computing the moments using this inner product become very easy now because the Chebyshev polynomial form an orthonormal base. So then things become much easier to compute the moments. And so this is this polynomial I've just shown you how it looks like. We don't need to go over the detail of the coefficients. We just need to know what are his properties. Its properties is that it integrates to one, so it gives you a nice density function, probability density function. And the first property actually is that it's non-negative over the interval minus 1, 1. Outside it may become, it becomes negative. But at least on the range minus 1, 1, which is where you are interested to look at, it's non-negative. So now let's look, so okay, so we can analyze this one. But if you want to get an SDP bound, we should optimize over a set of polynomials which contains that one as a special case. So what we are going to do, so you have a polynomial which is non-negative on the interval of the real line. Then by Markov Lukács, you know that it can be written as a sum of square plus sum of square times 1 minus x square. So this is this. If you have this delta, if you have a polynomial which is non-negative on minus 1, 1, then you can write it as sigma 0 plus sigma 1, 1 minus x squared. Well, these things are sums of squares of degree, and this degree is at most the degree of delta. Yeah. So this is on the real line. And now if you want to do on the cube, you are going to do a product of these things, and you are going to end up with a polynomial in the of Schmidgen type, a conic combination of products of these things, which are going to describe the box with sums of square multipliers. So this is why we look at this Schmidgen type upper bound, which is now the infimum of F, this density function H. So now we look at this measure instead of the Lebesgue measure. And our H now is a conic combination of products of constraints with sums of square multipliers. And the reason why we choose it this way, I repeat, is because our original, so the polynomial which we can analyze falls within this set. And what we can show, together with Roxana Hess, who is doing her PhD in Toulouse with Jean Lasserre, we can analyze and show that you can have a 1 over R square convergence rate. And this comes by looking at the shape of these coefficients over there. Okay, so I think I will stop here. Let me just conclude with a remark that actually everything I've told you, I have not said a single word about analysis of Putinard bound. And so we had only this beginning result, which I told you of Jia Wang Ni and Markus Schweighofer, who showed the convergence rate in 1 over root to some power of logarithm of R. We don't know. I mean, there is no other result which are known. They are much more difficult to analyze. So put in our type bounds. So thank you very much. Not depending on F. Probably it will be necessary, at least for because there is no polynomial time approximation scheme, for instance, for optimization of the cube. So if you would have a constant which depends only on the degree on the cube, then you would get a polynomial time approximation scheme. So that's the reason why we could not get this. So over the simplex, we got the pitas. So you could object that, well, we could compute alpha via optimization over the simplex, but it was 1 over alpha. So this, there was no contradiction. So even if you have a pitas for optimization of a simplex, it does, because it's 1 over alpha that you obtain, it doesn't translate into a pitas for alpha. But for the cube, it was alpha equals. So that's why you couldn't have. Yeah. Yeah, so it's a different notion of pitas in a sense. Huh? You have this range of values. So you could look at such representations, yes. So, but you're asking whether such representations could be analyzed. So you mean if you start with a sparse polynomial F? Yeah. So yeah. So for instance, for Putinard type representations, it's indeed true there are. Results which tell you that if you start with a polynomial f, which is sparse, which has a nice sparse representation, then you will get a sum of square representations of Putinard type, which is also sparse. So yes, there are such results, yes. So and the sparsity would be, of a kind that you have a chordal structure on the set, on the variables. A chordal type structure. So say your polynomial F has monomials which involve only Z group of variables and Z group of variables and Z group of variables. And these groups have the so-called running intersection property. Or you can see them as the maximal clicks of a chordal graph. And then if you have such a polynomial, then there is a sum of square representations which respects this structure. And the convergence holds.